Keep
good
and
welcome
and welcome.
I am Mika
M O
E A and I'm here with a new track.
New
and that is on the problem with long distance relationship. This is part of the remix of Reordering the Marriage Vows for the 21st Century. I'd like to welcome each and every one of you and say thank you very much for tuning in to the show. We're carrying this show over to this particular speaker
audio
from a previous session with Blog Talk. And as you know, we have been featuring Reordering the Marriage Vow. We have a marriage clinic and a divorce clinic where we counsel with couples. And today, I'd like to talk about something that I have experienced dealing long with this long distance relationship. Now, most of you know I was previously engaged, and I'd like to talk to you a little bit about that episode. Ladies and gentlemen, I can say for the record that I was very much in love. At least I thought I was very much in love. We were both in love. And as you stand across the internet, across the spread, we were expressing that love that we had for each other and by engaging in our issues and workshops and seminars and radio shows. And I was ready for love. At least I thought I was. However, ladies and gentlemen, sometimes we have got to make sure not just when love is in love, we're loved. And my uncle came to me unexpectedly, someone who I had known many years ago, and who I definitely had something called passion for. So I was expecting another night in the summer, and I did tell him that. However, it's not ever as legit that he was due us. It was that the fact that I was glad I was bad he came back, and I was really happy to be in love again and wanted to be in love. And as a matter of fact, ladies and gentlemen, I'm still in love. I'm still in love. Yes, I am. I am. Say it like Al Green. And I'd like to say, I'm still in love with you. Sometimes we have to look at the ups and the downs and the sides of things and make a decision whether or not to go forward or to put the car in neutral. Right now, I'll say my car is in neutral. I won't say I won't forward or going backward. I do know I did know that we did put on marriage on hold, and I can announce that and say that the marriage is placed on hold. Now, whether or not the cumbersome problem of a long-distance relationship causes problems, I won't ever be able to tell. But I can tell you some of the complications that we found while dealing with some long-distance relationship. And they go along with the territory, and I'm not going to lie to you. Some of these issues that I'm about to mention goes along with the territory. And I will name off each one of them. One of them is no accountability. When you're dating someone, dating a long one, and it's a long-distance relationship. And it is very, very hard for identity situation. Fraudulent activity can go on. And then you also have a problem with a lack of trackability. Now, I say that I want to say this for that not every man that you meet is a scoundrel or that he is hiding behind another profile. But you have got to use reason and don't throw caution to the wind. Whenever a man is engaged to someone outside of his home city, on his where he can be tracked, easy for a man to end the play two roles. Just as he play two roles. And it becomes fun sometimes. Everyone likes to put on a different character and go to a different city and play out a whole completely new role or a different role or one that the one you're with. For me, it's fun, gets up and people enjoy it. Going. Let me say, now let me write this record. Like, you don't play games with people like. You don't think one thing while you're doing another. You don't go having a family in upstate New York and then go to Maryville, Indiana, and then decide to have another family too, so that they won't ever run into each other. And we just don't do that. And when you try to do an international, ladies and gentlemen, get a replica background check. Not only to check if they've been married, but to check if they owe back taxes or have lien on their property, or that whether or not they'll be bringing debt into your life. Because you will have to be responsible. You marry that man and he has debt. You say this, let me just say for the record. The first thing you must receive, you must have acquired never honest person. Never say, marry this out for you right up for some time. I know the excitement of someone asking you to marry them and you waiting for so long. You don't want to keep them waiting and you want to give them the answer right away. That's wrong. You want to hold out the answer that you change things out. That's right. That's what you're going to have to background that. I don't care how much that man says he loves you and looks you in the eyes and all the beautiful things he want to give you. You have to find out, is this man looking to get a hold of your finances to get into your account to get close to car to your deposit man? Is he and really has something he has something to bring to the table? It's very vital that you look at these things, ladies and gentlemen, because they're not something that you want to play around with, and you certainly don't want to give your whole savings over to someone. Not that I'm saying that I had to go through it. I'm saying that your errors, you don't feel them at bay. And you learn to use earn this own person and share with him, because he could be a perfect stranger until you get to know all of his routines. And that's another thing. When you're not in the same city as the man, you don't know what his routines are. You don't know what he's doing, know what he's away from. You don't know if he's killing on another or complete the whole team where he's dating you, he goes home and Miss Sally and Miss Sally see him on Saturday, so it's perfectly okay because he's with you Monday through Thursday. Now, if you're going to be sharing a man, and if you happen to be in a situation where you go along with polygamy, and you're not going along, just get along to get you well above and have the man having another family, sit down, then sit down, a discussion and a meeting of the mind so that everybody's in on the deal and that nothing is concealed. And concealing things can cause a problem when you're not well aware of what's going on. And I'm saying this for the man because I want you to know that when a man starts this from you, he will do it. He lied, he will cheat, and he will steal. Go together as a cohabitat. And it's very, very vital that you should understand that you want to be in control. You don't want to be the last to know. Now, in my long-distance relationship, I found it was a problem to come, where I had to keep constantly putting myself on the calendar, making sure that I wasn't for, and that there was a date set for us to see each other. We didn't have a regular date on a regular basis. It was whenever. I didn't like that, and I should have did something about it a long time ago and had regular dates and times that I would end, that I would game with my boat. I should have been more cautious of the fact that it could be for winter months with the weather, and it was very difficult, but we managed through it. We were very fortunate that we managed through the hardest part of the weather, and we were able to see each other. But what I'm talking about is about you want to get things checked out. You haven't his name been good. People who haven't had, you haven't had a chance to read any family or family. You feel like you're an outsider. So when they're discussing things, you become an outsider. And no matter what you feel or think about things, you don't have proper input to engage in a family conversation. So that puts you in a bay. As if you're outside, you're alienated, and you're not agreeing with your opinion, because you've been alienated the whole time you've been dating, and you don't have an opinion. Well, you might want to make some visits here, down where you live, And you might want you want to not only show your face, show your head, but your friends have a month and spam so you have input and topics and conversation that involve you. Now, don't let him go and put his daughters and children in front of you constantly as if he's raising toddlers. If children are grown, then you must say to him, say that I prefer you to come and me, ask me what I do before you go and making arrangements and not including me in your scenario, and your daughters and sons are coming before me. Make it a precedent and a rule of thumb that he includes you in as a family member, a regular family member, even if absent your even as a dude FBI will not include you in. He makes some decision or the family is engaging in a decision. Now I want you to know that it's very, very vital, very vital that you should understand that no person can have it all together. The main thing they must take you tell your boss. We find love can find love will cover a multitude of inadequacy. And if you can convince that person that if you are in love, then it's easier to forgive any inadequacy, then you well on your way. But if he is holding you accountable to you every error, problem, every that might encounter, might be a relationship, constant, and he's constantly bringing all up the error of the errors that he's forgiving you for, you have to set that man down or that woman and tell him, look, I'm human and I'm going to err, but I'm going to ask you to forgive me. And if you forgive him, I don't have to hear you to secure about it. I know you don't mind yet. Forgive, you have to learn from the worst in your mistakes. Can't you can forgive, learn to forgive, and not rub it in their face constantly? The relationships are difficult as it is. Now, when other households that are dissidents start to have or experience or financial problems or conditions in their home, their family, or their family, they tend to want to put your relationship on hold. To attend to their own issues without including you, of course. Don't let them do that. Make them include you in resolving the problem so you'll be a part of helping resolve the solution. And they won't act as if you are the outsider causing the problem. When this happens, you tap yourself by alien of a native, them, a tribe. What we're trying is a tribal effect to keep our relationships. But we're part of each other and we're family. So, if you are dealing with problems in long-distance relationship, what are the first things that things show? What are the tell and what side of time? Number one, they can't make the appointment. They start to get excuses why they can't be with you or why they can't come. And if you become oppositional, then they can call you argumentative and say, well, you are causing unhappiness and I want happiness in my relationship. You have to tell that person, tell that person, in order to keep peace, there must be peace. He just can't concede all the time when he's bringing the heat. Some men will bring the heat and start the argument and run and hide the rock behind their backs and say, see there, I told you that you always start an argument. When in fact, he would have begun to initiate the initial argument and running like a coward when you step up and respond. Don't let him always create skeletons out of the closet to argue about, and he knows it's going to catch you for a loop and cause you to respond, and now it looks like you're the only one carrying the argument as you try to justify yourself. You don't have to justify yourself. Because that's the justification will come if you're quiet and you sit still, because silence is good as gold. I want you to know another thing. Long distance relationship can become a problem when and the person wants to convince you just when you just land you up to be out of town, be out of town, out the house. And don't let a man off on you just because he's anxious to get with you and he's showing up without a phone call. Tell him, you must notify me in advance if you're coming so I'll know and I can make preparation for you. It's very vital that you buy that, ladies and gentlemen. It's very vital. I want you to know that. And I want you to also know that he can do things a little bit differently and keep peace and harmony in a relationship. Long-distance relationships are noisy all by themselves. Whenever that person heard that in from my town, I usually carry a lot of baggage with my baggage. And I just don't mean luggage. I mean and physical and mental issues that he's carrying with the trip on the train. The track had to cross another track to get on another train, so the train became delayed. You can meet me by the highway. You can meet me on the train. You can meet me by the Facebook. I don't care. Yeah, get here if you can. And there's so many miles between you, and you're on flight. And then you're on mega bus. And then you get on the trailway. And some folks even put in a car and a car drive to drive through 86 snow. It can be some problems, situations. But oh, the joy of when that person gets there and arrives. The joy that meets each one of your heart is so great that you soon forget about the long trip. And you wish that you could stay over for a month, or I wouldn't get on, have to train on or train bus and or the bus go turn around and back home. But you must check out the background of that person's activities in the neighborhood in his vicinity. But when a man starts to find every excuse as to why he no longer can stay in a relationship, and how folks that are just date, married, supposed to be married, find out he's finding a reason why it is not working, and that he feels that it will never work, and there's no sense in trying one day. And then the next day he says, let's start all over again, and let's begin anew. But then the next following week, he's like, we discussed this, aren't we, this recognition, we break it off. If he is doing these things, you need to have it. Because maybe the date that's approaching that you initially was going to get married is frightening him. And the closer he gets to the date, now he realizes that this date was closer than whatever he thought before. And boy, he's got a man. Now he's decided to make some decisions. What's home? Leave his hometown. Move there and move you there with you. Sweep you off your feet. Find a new dwelling. Or whether he grabs you up and all your things and brings him back to his hometown. If none of that has been figured out yet, this man is afraid and he's scared to death of what his next move is because he has not badly planned it out. You can help a woman, help a plan to plan it out. You can talk about him. About what are your plans to proceed with our housing and living dwelling? Do you perceive me to move out of my neighborhood and for us to get a home together? Or do you perceive that I will come to your hometown and live? But you have got all these planned things out. They don't just by themselves. You have to be very clear. Realize just saying we want to be married is not enough. Preparation and proper preparation has to be made. Now, lady, don't go beat that man over the head. It's because you've done some background checking and you've found some things about background that he's still paying child support. He should be jumping up to the ceiling. Because that's the thing he should tell you, that there's money coming out of my bank account or they're garnishing my bank, is garnishing my check to pay some old child support fees. But he should inform you. Being informed is the best measurement of a good relationship. A man should conceal or seal, or a woman should conceal anything from her. Be out there in the open. And it's vital that you should have that discussion. And ladies and gentlemen, I want to say this for the record. Being engaged can be beautiful. The loving, loving. of times that you spend together, maybe you dance, you enjoy the dance, enjoy drawing and spend down the aisle, maybe you sing, maybe you're songers and you want singing. You couldn't get these things from some relationship, no matter how hard you try. They must come naturally. And if they're coming natural for you, you got something going on. And don't let a man destroy it for you, because they don't know what to do, know what you build up and build together. But now he wants to marry the person and parmental and just speak to that man and him that these relationships do not come once in a lifetime. And for him to take some time to really think and sort that thing out before he dismantled that relationship and give up on it. Now, of course, if he's got plenty of women back home, where he's got women problems, and I'm all waiting, they're all there turning for them, and turn back, and they've been there, now he finally feels that he's free, and he can get with them, it might be easier to go down the path of the less resistance. And sometimes they do, and if they choose to go down the path of the less resistance, let them go, let them go, let him go, let him go. Oh, let her or let go. Because when you hold on, want to be out of the relationship, because now they've got to make some big decision, you'll have nothing but problems. Give him a little time. If this relationship is meant to be, he'll come back, kicking and screaming, saying, boy, what I have is a good thing, good one, I want to it, math, want to hold on to it, hold on, I want to keep a key to see heart and develop. But let him or her be the one to come to you. Don't push everything along and like you're kicking a can down the street because you're trying to accomplish something. Let the relationship unfold on its own. And if it's not meant not to be, dry, then because it's going to be shedding. And you're going to be hurt if it was a true love. You're going to feel so down and out, and you're going to need someone to counsel with and talk to. You can counsel with Omi. You can call me on the phone at any time and counsel with me. Because I might need to invite you, call and counsel you the way about him. So leave the blessing for go over the way, either way, both ways. Because a good counselor should have a good listening ear for someone who needs help. And she should also be able to confide in someone as well. And therefore, I say that it's very vital that you stand under the relationship. Relationships already have our problems, have their problems along with our territory. But problems set themselves in long-distance relationships. They're just more abundant and more hard to deal with. And because you know they're going to be set, you have got to be prepared. You've got to rule out a lot of problems that can continue to set you to be unbeknown on you. And to you, it's very vital that we get this together. So, because there's so many out there that would love to date me, I know. And I would love to date so many of those good guys out there. But because distance is between us, there are many miles between us. There are many distances. And we know this. Know that we have to plan strategically so that we not a good relationship on account of distance. Distance can make the heart grow fonder, and it can sometimes make that man wonder. And if we're out there looking for another woman, we're in a long-distance relationship, shame on you. Because relationship, give that relationship mellow to develop, mellow out. Put everything you got in it. Especially when you get to be 60-year-old people and you know love doesn't come too often. Knocking at your door. Come on in, love. And I've been waiting for you. Wait. It doesn't come like that. Like that. It doesn't. It does. And whenever it comes, whenever it comes at you, showers you. And it's you let love in. Because when you get 60 years old and an elder and you still got it, baby, you better flaunt it and you better hold on to it. For those foolish men, you should have let good loving affairs go. Because they just don't ever want to put anymore. For them, feel so I for you. Sorry for this, let it be the last one for you. You may not see love anymore. Not in this century, not until you do a full cycle and recycle yourself back into a newborn child. You're an elder. You're on your way out. You're on your way to becoming an eldership down to the ancestral ship. Oh man, if you don't make it, ship your eldership, you might as well. You will see love later, much later, until you recycle into a new child. And you don't want to have to wait until a new child comes on the scene to start all over. If you got love in your lips, in your grasps, in your head, and you're holding to it, learn to fix it. Fix it. Apologize. Say sorry. Take that grievance and put it on the shelf. Stop holding your pride in high esteem and forgive somebody and humble yourself. It's okay to say I made a mistake. I was wrong. It's okay to start. Can we start again? It's okay to be a better man. What is not okay? To be a damn coward and run somewhere and tuck your heads between your legs and say, it's not my fault. It's all her fault. Every couple has to share 50% of whatever error they're going through. No one is always fully wrong, but it's vital that we be able to see this before things get too going down the road hard and we quit. Call it quit. How quick are we so quick to call it quits? Oh, foolishness. Don't let any other outside person step into your relationship who's supposed to be a friend. And now you're honoring their friendship and you're dishonoring your significant other's commitment when you have been bound in this person with them for years. Many know and you know them. And trust you're trusting your judgment to us. And you're walking away from your significant other because you feel she has misrepresented you. Why would she do that if she's giving her hand to your hand in your marriage? It's vital that why she really weak things think to us. What because we ever set to hands will crumble because we have not dealt wisely in our affairs. And a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. Not just in that situation, but all his ways. A double minded or woman for that matter. That is very vital. The right of stop. We should take up an inventory of ourselves. I'm going to take a short break. Excuse me. Taking an inventory of ourselves would mean that we would chill with back to see the air. If we said wrong, something in the wrong way, or was truly in our actions, or possibly have assessed the situation wrongly, or misrepresented the situation, it's always room for error. And it's very vital that we should be big enough a human being to be willing that we'll take responsibility. My say it's my fault. It's my fault. I am. I want to fix it. Can I fix it? Will you allow me to fix it? But for those men who have never had love in their life, and who have never had an engagement or marriage, and they're looking to throw away good marriages, and they wonder why one can't they get out of it, get well, or find a good one. Some be destroying their relationship with their own hands. Their very own hands, ladies and gentlemen. And I want to give you an anecdote to prevent you from throwing in the towel because of your cowardice or your fearfulness and frightfulness. There's nothing to fear but fear itself. You never go into a relationship. It is a threefold cord. God is at the center of that relationship. So whatever is wrong while you're engaged, You and that significant other go before the Lord on your knees to petition Him to help you correct things in that relationship. Don't go, you don't mean the relationship up and are sealing you up to that significant other and you making the full decision that is never going to work. You come to agreements to get counsel. You come together to counsel each other. You never let one spouse in a relationship or in the relationship decide that it's over without giving the other person a proper chance to make things right. Relationships have to have a chance to grow. And they cannot grow if we are constantly developing reasons why they shouldn't grow. If we do not properly attend to relationships, they won't grow. If we have vowed to be absent, lazy, our relationship will fall apart. But if we put in the proper time in, and we're investing with all our whole heart, and the love that we have, we're not being stingy. We're not only cleaving to ourselves, and holding on to our love, to our, providing ourselves, fully, also now.